created us, who's in charge of everything. He's the one who deserves our praise. So let's stand and let's sing together.
Shall rise to thee.
On God Walker Sunday, we take time to write down names of people in our lives who need a new or renewed walk with God, or to recognize those who have begun or renewed their walk with God. The prayer team then prays over the names when they meet together each week. And you'll find little slips of paper under seats to fill out if there's any names you would like to share. And thank you to everyone who was able to share last time. Also, you can continue to submit any names you want virtually via email to prayers, requests, praises at prayer@path2jesusway.org. I'm going to read from Titus 3:4-7, which is part of our reading today. But when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, who he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. So celebrate that undeserved, generous gift of eternal life, and keep praying for those around you that they may accept this gift also.
Teaching, rebuking, correcting. Good morning. So you all remembered to set your clocks one way or the other. What was it? Ahead?
All back.
So did we gain an hour or did we lose an hour? I got an extra hour of sleep. But I woke up at 5:30 instead of 6:30. And I didn't know why, but that explains it. So, does that mean the people that forgot are going to show up?
No.
They showed up already. Okay, some of you were trying to get to the first service and you're here right now. You don't have to raise your hand. Good to have you. Let's try our mission statement. Do you have it back there? There it is. On the path.
Walking with him, each other, supporting each other's walk with God, in the world, sharing God's love.
Amen. Okay, did you notice that's our dream? Right? The dream was we have a hand reaching up. Talked about this a few weeks ago. And then we have a hand reaching out. And so we're focusing on God and each other. There's a two-stage thing. It's each other, but we want to make a difference in the world as well. Do we have anyone that is bringing their child for the Bible thing, my Bible? Over here? Anyone else? Come on up. Do we have the microphone somewhere? There it is. Yeah, when you get to be 60, whatever that is, that's what happens. All right, so you're finishing children's worship, right? Right, you're graduating? Congratulations, wow. How old do you have to be to, yeah, go ahead. How old do you have to be to graduate?
9.
Turn 9
this summer.
Okay, so it looks like your parents got you a Bible. Do you have a verse and so on?
Got this Bible last year. Okay. 2019, which seems so long ago now. but I chose for Luke Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them, for the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. So I just thought that was a really good verse to keep in mind as you get older and continue your walk with God.
Yes. All right. Thank you. What Bible did you give me?
The Hands-On Bible. I think it's very similar to the one that we got.
The New Living. Oh, that's cool.
And as you read through it, it's really easy to read, but then also, like, this verse is completely different.
Yeah, because the Lord himself goes before you, and he will be with you. He will never leave you or forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, is how I learned it.
What I read is even different than what his is. So I'm right. Like, we may have to rethink this, but we'll see. I think it's good for the age that he's in.
It is. Yeah, to understand. Yep.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations.
Okay.
All right. All right, and do we have any, what's the other one? Little Lambs. Little Lambs?
I do have the twins too. But they're now in kindergarten.
Yeah, but are they graduating from Little Lambs?
No.
Okay. Anyone? Any adult want one? It's really, you know, there's things to color and you can learn your letters. Huh? No? All right. By the way, you know, we have these lunch bags up when you leave for the kids and so on. So there's somebody has specifically put this all together. It's a mystery. Who knows what's inside? It's a surprise. So pick one up. There's one marked November, but we have some left over from October 25. So if some of you adults want to try the lesson, you know, there's stuff in here. I want to know what's in there. I'm sure you do too. All right. Jim, are you going to pray?
Thank you. Let's bow our heads and join God in our congregational prayer. God, in our readings this week, Second Timothy 1, we learned not to be ashamed to testify for your gospel. Lord, we also learned that we may have to suffer in that testifying. But Lord, we know that it also tells us that you have all power, and we put our trust in you. God, you ask us to live holy lives. Just be with us as we try to serve you and be an example to others. Lord, we do this not of anything that we have done, but because of what you have done through the grace you have given us through Jesus Christ. God, as we come together, we think of the next coming week. I just got out of a prayer meeting time with the youth, Lord, and there's just a lot of things going on in our world with the COVID stuff and different things, Lord, in schools. Many of the schools are, especially the colleges, are sending kids back home, Lord. We just pray as all these changes happen. Some kids are going to school, some are at home learning. There's just a lot of changes. We just ask that you be with all these kids as they go through these changes. We're just thankful that we have a God that is our rock, that never changes, Lord, and just help us to put our trust in you as we deal with this uncertain time. We also have an election this week, Lord. We just pray that your will be done, that things will be done peacefully and orderly, but ultimately, Lord, that we know that you are the one in control. You are our master. I also wanted to pray for the names or any people that have come to know you this past month, Lord. We just pray for those names that are being written down and will be written down. We just ask that you walk alongside them. Lord, we have many prayer requests from the people in our congregation. Sue Ann Watkins is going through a COVID recovery. But she wound up back in the hospital, Lord. We just pray that you be the doctors and give them wisdom as they deal with that. Also, earlier we were praying for Jose Colon as he was waiting a COVID result test and is dealing with severe symptoms. We just had received a text as our church started that and he did test positive for COVID. So we ask that you also be with him as the doctors deal with that. Continue to be with Bev Sutter and her healing. Also be with Tracy Busker, Rick and Peggy's daughter. She is back in the hospital with complications dealing with her cancer. Also will be with Tina Vanderlaan as she goes to inpatient therapy. Pray for healing. And also be with Andy and the kids as they are at home. Be with Bob Coney. Give him healing from his surgery. Continue to be with Kathy Tillman as she recovers. Continue to be with Karen Belknap as she continues her cancer treatments. We just thank you for all the blessings that you have given her so far. Continue to be with Jim Ostreich as he has to deal with the loss of his wife, Lord, and just be with that family as things are different. Also be with the Greg and Sarah Byron family as they are dealing with sickness this morning. Be with Sandy Farlow as she deals with medical issues and needs to have a tumor removed. Lord, we just pray that her body will heal well enough so that might happen. Just a lot of requests, Lord. There's a lot of sickness out there, a lot of people that need you as their doctor. We just ask that you cover them all with your mercy and grace. In this service now, be with Steve as he brings the message. In praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
You can just take it with you. Nope, you can take it all. Whatever you like up here, you just take it with you. Need bells? We got those. Having a personal walk with God. A search for God. It's interesting, my watch, I haven't worn my watch in a long time, but I guess I set Toy Story on it. So Toy Story, every time I look at it, Toy Story characters come on. And just while we were praying, I looked at it, and there was Buzz Lightyear. To infinity and beyond. And I think we are all Buzz Lightyear. We all gravitate towards beyond. Something that there has to be something beyond our life. I think our search for God, our connection to God, is the absolute most important thing in our life. And as my time is sort of winding down, I wanted to remind us all about that. The search for God is universal. It's all over the world, all over history. These are the pyramids of Giza. There are over 2,300,000 stones to build this pyramid. 2,300,000. And each one is like a ton and a half. This is the size of each one of those stones. Someone said it would cost $5 billion to build this pyramid today. So why were they built? They were built by a pharaoh that had more power than any person on the planet, but his power could not increase the span of his life. And so he either was trying to live forever, connect to God, or he was trying to be God. And they went through all this work just to do that. In our culture, our movies, our blockbuster movies, The Lord of the Rings, it's really just a ripoff of the Bible. It's the story of good versus evil and how evil is incredibly powerful and the good, it seems, always small. And Frodo is kind of a Jesus character, unlikely person who comes and saves the whole thing. The story is the exact same thing in Star Wars. This is what George Lucas, the one who put that together, said. Star Wars is designed primarily to make young people think about the mystery. Not to say here's the answer, it's to say think about this for a second. Is there a God? What does God look like? What does God sound like? What does God feel like? How do we relate to God? This is some obscure movie, maybe you've never seen it, but I thought the dialogue between this guy and his therapist was very interesting, because I think as people search for God, sometimes they get frustrated in that search for God, and then I think a lot of people in our culture just give up. So he says, I'd like to believe in God, but I've just never seen any proof, so I just don't debate it anymore. You know, it's like I can spend my whole life thinking it over and over again and weighing up the pros and cons, and in the end, I still wouldn't have any proof. So I just don't debate it anymore. It's absurd. I think that's where a lot of people are. They've tried to figure out God. They were motivated at one time to figure out God. You know, different religions, different things that are promoted, and they looked there, here, and looked there, and they can't figure it out. And it doesn't make any sense. So at some point, you just quit. And you go, you know what? I'm just going to leave that question alone, and I'm going to go after other things. But the problem is, when you give up the search for God, what other things are there? So it's interesting that he says it's absurd, and then the doctor says the search for God is absurd. And then Donnie says, it is if everyone dies alone. Dr. Thurman, does that scare you? I don't want to be alone. Okay, so on the one hand, it's frustrating. A lot of people are frustrated in their search for God, and then they give up, but then you're left with nothing. You're left with being all alone. What is it all about? And so I think people are just, you know, stuck in between that. So I think there's another option, and that is just keep busy. Keep busy with your life. Fill it with all the noise that you can, and then you just never think about it. I found this, and it has nothing to do with my sermon, but I thought it was interesting. I asked God for a bike, but I know God doesn't work that way, so I stole a bike and asked for forgiveness. All right, this is Carl Sagan. He hosted a show years ago
called the cosmos scientist. He writes, the cosmos is within us. We're made of star stuff. We are a way for the cosmos to know itself. And I have no idea what that means. He went on to say, I would love to believe that when I die, I will live again, that some thinking, feeling, remembering part of me will continue. But as much as I want to believe that, and despite the ancient and worldwide culture and traditions that assert an afterlife, I know of nothing to suggest that it is more than wishful thinking. So here's a scientist, person who, you know, spent his whole life looking at science and the universe, and he couldn't find any proof for God, so he just concluded there must not be a God. But notice, I would love to believe that that desire is planted within us. The Bible says eternity has been planted in the heart of human beings. That desire for God is there, even if you don't believe it. Even if you have no proof, it's still there. This is a statue of Marcus Aurelius. He was the last great emperor of Rome. He wrote a little book called The Meditations. And I think this is sort of the conclusion. If there is no God, then this is what's true. The time that, therefore, that any man doth live is but a little. And the place where he liveth is but a little corner of the earth. And the greatest fame that can remain of a man after his death, even that is but a little. And that too, such as it is whilst it is by the succession of silly mortal men preserved, who likewise shall shortly die. So you live your life, soon you die. Soon the people that knew you die, and soon the memory of you dies, and that's all there is. I think, you know, now that's a stark reality. And so people, I think this is in some sense how they think. Paul said, you know, let's eat and drink and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And I think a lot of our culture, that's what we're doing. Let's just busy ourselves up and not think about this thing. Freddie Mercury. Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Anyway, the wind blows doesn't really matter to me. If I'm not back again this time tomorrow, carry on as if nothing really matters. Nothing really matters. Anyone can see nothing really matters. Nothing really matters to me. The theme song of a lot of people. This is a book called Homo Deus. And here's a quote from it. For a millennia, humans struggled with three serious problems: famine, plagues, war. These issues contributed to the deaths of millions of people and resulted in the rise and fall of global empires. However, in the modern era, we've mostly overcome these three problems through the development of technology and medical knowledge. Okay, so these are the things that drove us for centuries and centuries and centuries. These are the things, these problems and attacking these problems, trying to do something about these problems, consumed our purpose and our meaning. Okay? Now what this book is saying is those have been taken care of. So we need new goals. Consequently, we now look toward new goals. And what are they? Immortality, happiness, and divinity. These will guide us to the next phase of our evolution from Homo sapiens to Homo Deus. Homo means man, and Deus means God, or God-like beings. So there are incredibly wealthy people today who are working night and day to try to figure out how they can live forever. I just read about co-founders of Google, Jeff Bezos of Amazon, all pouring millions and millions of dollars into technology that can solve this problem of getting old and dying. And they want to solve it. And some of them are really, you know, like, you know, these incredibly wealthy people. They have all these millions and millions of dollars, but it's not going to help them live beyond 100 years. All the money in the world doesn't help you. That wasn't what the pharaohs did. They built these pyramids, but it didn't work. So they're spending all this money. For $80,000, by the way, you can have your head frozen. And then one day, hopefully, the technology is there that can bring you back. Although I don't know who wants to bring you back. That's the other problem. you better start talking to your grandkids, and they have to talk to your great-grandkids and so on, and you gotta really, you know, have a positive legacy or no one's bringing you back. So all these incredibly wealthy people are working really hard at this, because once you give up the idea of God and eternity and all those things that Christianity talks about, what have you got left? And if you go to things like Netflix and Amazon and all these video places, you'll find movie after movie these days about going to Mars. Why all of a sudden are we interested in going to Mars? Because we got to get off this planet eventually. If the human race is going to exist, because eventually the sun burns out and the earth freezes over, and so we got to get off this planet eventually. So people are trying to find purpose and meaning. They're letting go of this notion of God. And so once you let go of the notion of God, guess what you have to do? You either have to go into denial about the whole thing, or you have to be God. That's what happened in Genesis 3, right? Genesis 3. The devil comes and said, you know that God is withholding godhood from you. You could be like God if you take this fruit. You take things into your own hands. There's another perspective. It's from the Bible. This is Job. I know that my Redeemer lives, that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. Jeremiah, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. King David, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. Paul, at the capital city of Greece, Athens. Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Now what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the times set for them and exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he's not far from each one of us. God's search for you. Genesis 3. Then the man and the wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden, but the Lord called to the man, "Where are you?" God wants to be found. God wants a relationship with us. So, beginning a walk with God. So, I want to just go back to what we did a couple of weeks ago. We started with the dream. Everyone has the same dream. They have a hand reaching up to God, or whatever they think God is, the force, nature, whatever it is. And they have a hand reaching out. They want a good relationship with the people around them. They want to make a difference in the world. But we're thwarted in this dream because of sin. Adam and Eve hid from each other, they hid from God. So God comes and he says, this is what you want. You want a connection to me, you want a connection to the people around you, guess what, I will tell you how to do it. So he lays down the Ten Commandments. First ten, four commandments deal with their relationship to God. This is how you do it. Next six deal with their relationship to people. This is how you do it. So we want it, God tells us how to do it, but because of sin, we're hiding from the very thing that we want. And so we have all this brokenness that we see in our world today. So we talked about the only way that it's going to work is we need grace. We need God to come and get us out of the hiding. So we talked about God's grace. God's grace won by Jesus on the cross. So we had last weekend grace on this side. This is what God does. But how does that grace get to us? God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. That's God's side of the equation. That whoever believes should not perish but have everlasting life. That's on this side of it. This is what we do. But then we started looking at verses, and God's involved in our belief as well. And the Holy Spirit somehow is involved in this line from God's grace to getting us to the point of believing. And so we looked at a Holy Spirit verse, John 3, verse 8. The wind blows where it blows. You can't see where it's going or where it's coming from or where it's going. So it is with anyone born of the Holy Spirit. So that mystery of God's grace getting to us is translated to us by the Holy Spirit, but it's kind of a mystery. Like, how exactly does that work? We don't control the Spirit of God. There's not stuff that we just do and it automatically happens. But we talked about, well, then what can we do? We talked about a windy path. We don't control the wind, but we know where the wind blows or where the wind has blown. So we talked about four windy paths. One is knowledge, more you know about the Bible and church history and those kinds of things. It doesn't save you. Your knowledge doesn't save you. Your Bible knowledge doesn't save you. But it's a place where the Holy Spirit tends to work. And we talked about commitment, making a commitment to Christ. Commitment does not save you. Just because you make a commitment to Jesus Christ, that does not save you. Jesus still saves you. The commitment is a windy place, however. The Holy Spirit likes to work with that commitment thing. And we talked about experience. Pentecostal churches, charismatic churches are big on giving you an experience of the Holy Spirit. Now, experience doesn't save you either, but it's a windy place. And then finally, we talked about ritual. Catholic churches, Lutheran churches, reading the Bible, praying, coming to church, those are all rituals. Rituals don't save you, but they are a windy place. The Spirit of God tends to work in those places. So then we asked, you know, these four different windy paths, what unites them? What are they all a part of? And we concluded they're all part of a thing called a relationship. When you are beginning a relationship, you have a ritual of meeting that person, and over time you get to know them more, you experience more, and then your commitment to them grows over time. So we ended up talking about how God's grace comes to us in a relationship over time. And that's the way grace happens in all of our lives. It happens over time in a relationship through the ups and the downs. So, we want to begin a relationship with God. Well, then how do we do it? We need to know God more. We need to experience God more. We need more of a commitment to God. So what can we do? We start with a ritual. The ritual of relationship. And what is the ritual of relationship? It consists of three things. Talking.
Repeatedly.
So? That's what we have here. Talking, listening, repeatedly. And that's true about any relationship. You want a relationship with anyone, it takes talking, listening, repeatedly. If you meet someone for the first time, you end up having a nice discussion with them, and you never see them again in your life, you're not going to have much of a relationship. So talking, listening, repeatedly. What do we call talking to God? Prayer. What do we call the most trustworthy way to listen to God? It's through the Bible. Okay, what do we call the habit of praying to God and reading the Bible? What do we call that? What?
Emotions.
Emotions. Very good. You all know it. You just don't want to be wrong. All right, so devotions. So, now, growing up in my life, devotions. It's one of the things. Yeah, we go to church, we this, we that, we do devotions. I never thought of it as I thought of it as a thing, but not as the thing. But if you want a relationship with God, how can you have a relationship without talking and listening to God? So the Bible part. Now, this is what I thought was interesting. So every time I've ever done this talk about walking with God, you know, and I've done this thing for 20 years, okay? 20 years I've been talking about this. And in all my presentations, I always use John or 2 Timothy 3. 2 Timothy 3, 14 and 15. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. And then following the two famous verses about the Bible, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I've used this verse every time for the last 20 years. Now, a year ago, Pastor Jim thought, you know, let's read through the whole New Testament this year, and then he found this reading track, and then we have our preaching schedule, who's going to preach what, but that wasn't really set in stone. It was here, it was there, it was there, it was here, it was there. Then all of a sudden, Pastor Jim wanted to go on vacation for 2 weeks, so then I had to take these two lessons. So it's been a random thing, and on the very day that I want to talk about this, this was in our reading. This was what we read this week. Now, what are the chances of that? Now, I said that this morning, and the visitors, Adam and Aaron, were here, and their son, it's their son's birthday today. So she came up to me and said, you know, it's their son's birthday today, and whatever years ago it was, at his baptism, guess what verse they used? This one. Now, what are the chances of that? See, and I think that's, these are the things that happen when you walk with God. You walk with God and things happen. If you don't walk with God, then you don't have these things that just happen in your life. If you want God in your life, you have to actually walk with Him in your life. Prayer, Psalm 66, verse 19, God has surely listened and heard my voice in prayer. Okay, so how do you get a habit? What is a habit? Habit, you need a plan. Okay, that's, if you notice the pathway, we give you a plan. So this year, it's read through the whole Bible in a year. The goal, we're going to get through the whole New Testament in a year. Schedule, what is the schedule? Oh, look at the app. It just tells you, today's reading is this. Support. Okay, now the problem is habits are hard, right? So I don't know how well you're doing on this habit right now. Some of you are probably really doing well. Some of you are hit or miss. And some of you are doing pathetically, probably. And if you're struggling, it's because this is hard. But it's not hard. It's the easiest thing in the world. It really is. It's the easiest thing in the world. It's as easy as tying your shoes. It's as easy as brushing your teeth. But the reason it sometimes is hard is because you don't have the habit yet. To get a new habit is hard. But look at all the habits you already have. Is it hard to brush your teeth? You get up and do it. Some of you don't even open your eyes. You know, I go into the bathroom sometimes. My wife is in the shower. I walk in there and it's dark. She doesn't even turn the light on. She wants to, you know, 5 more minutes of sleep as she's standing in the shower. I don't know. But it's just automatic. You drive to work, you know. You get dressed every day. It's not hard. You just do it. So habits that you have are easy to do. It's only hard when you don't have it, when you're struggling with it. So what we need is support to get over the things that are holding us back from doing what we want. Right? We want a relationship with God. Isn't that true? So, procrastination. Now, some of you that are struggling with this, I'm giving you this message, and you're thinking in your mind, you know what? I'm going to get going with this tomorrow. Or the next one. Tomorrow's actually a busy day. I got something real early. So, Tuesday. No, that's voting day. Wednesday, that's when I'm going to do it. Oh, but I have to get over whatever the results are, and I'll be depressed or I'll be elated. Thursday. Procrastination. Huh? Critical attitude. I just don't like this whole reading. I don't like people telling me what to do. Lack of discipline. I just can't stick with anything. No accountability. What difference does it make? Who knows what you do or don't do, right? Unteachable attitude. No one's going to tell me what to do. But I think this is, for most of us, this is what it is. Too busy. I've just got other things. There's a lot of stuff that I got to do. I just don't have time for this. Which is really this. Other gods. Is there those things that you're doing, those things that you're busy with, is there anything of those things that are more important than your walk with God? No. So when we let those things take priority over our walk with God, then we're really saying those things are more important than God. So we need a plan, a goal, schedule, support. And maybe a little recognition. Philippians 3:17, join with others in following my example, says Paul, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. Years ago, when we started this reading plan, we had like trees, and when you finished a book of the Bible, you got a leaf on the tree, and you had to come up and get it, or we had little stickers to put on a chart. And you know what happened when we did that? You know what some people complained? They said, this is like Sunday school. And I wanted to say, I didn't say it, but I wanted to say, yeah, and that's the last time you did anything, was at Sunday school. So maybe the reality is we're all just children, and we all need a little bit of Sunday school. I don't know. Back to the dream. All right, sharing your walk with God. Remember, we have a dream of reaching to God. That's what we're talking about, our walk with God. But we also have a want to connect with others. We want to make a difference. Philemon 1:6 said, pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you'll have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. In other words, you don't know what you have in Christ until you share. How do we do that? Share what you know. And what do you know? I don't know. Whatever your walk is. What has God done in your life? Share that. Doesn't have to. You don't have to know everything. Well, I don't know. It doesn't matter. Just share what God has done in your life. And share what you do. Remember on a plane, I was talking to someone, and I asked him, what's your spiritual dream? And we went through that whole thing. And then finally, he looked at me and said, well, why do you believe in God? And I said, well, I believe in God because I talked to him this morning. He said, really? What did he say? And I took out my planner, which had the verse of that day, and I said, well, this is what he said, and I read it. I just have to share what I do. All right. So, we've been talking about our vertical relationship to God and how important that is, but it's sort of dependent on our horizontal relationships. Those things sort of go together. We have these seven connections. We have the things on the poles outside. And so I want to show how that goes together, especially as we head towards this week where we're voting and we have all this brokenness in our culture. So there's our relationship to God. That's a vertical relationship. That's where you start. But around that vertical relationship is your connection to a spouse. If you're married, then family. So if you want a close relationship with your spouse, your family, you have to have those things connected to God. Everything's dependent on that vertical relationship. Friends, again, connected to God. Church, again, that works. It works in a church when people are connected to God. Kingdom, okay, this is Christians all over the world. It all works. When people in the kingdom are connected to God. Now, we have all this brokenness that we see going on in our world today. It's an unprecedented year of brokenness and strife in families, in churches, in our communities at large. You just have to drive down any street. You got signs on one side of the fence, signs on the other side of the fence, and I hear people are stealing signs and swapping signs. We're having this sign warfare. You know, I've never heard of sign warfare, but we have sign warfare. So we have all this stuff going on. 50% of our culture is in church every Sunday. You would think if we're all connected to the same God that we could get along better than we are. So the key to all relationships is this connection to the vertical. And then finally, our world. So all these things are connected to the central thing, which is our walk with God. Pastor Jim put this little chart together long ago, and I like this part. So if our culture isn't connected to God, or if your family isn't connected to God, or your friendship network is not connected to God, in other words, all your inner relationships, you don't have this vertical connection to God, this is what happens to all the other relationships. It goes all over the place. And that's what we're seeing, I think, in our culture today. So as we go into this new week, the most important thing is your connection to God, in your family, your friends, your church, the kingdom, and all these things. And voting and elections and COVID-19, all those things do not change this. These are things that will be here today and gone tomorrow. But our connection to God and our connection to each other, those things are eternal. I'd like to, Marie, if you'd come up, I'd like to sing a song. It's a song I haven't done in a long, long time, but it's an old hymn I first heard James Ward singing. He sang this hymn, Rock of Ages, and he sang it to a different tune. And I, at the time, I was young at that time, and I didn't care for the hymns. I never listened to the hymns, I didn't listen to the words, but because he sang it with a different tune, it was like the first time I heard the song. And I guess why I want to sing it this morning is that opening line of the last line, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. A cleft is in a rocky part, and it's been hollowed out. So it's like this safe place. There's all the storms of life going all around you, and things that you've caused, things that are out of your control, and it's like God creates that safe space for you. And that's what our relationship to God is all about. Some are searching hard, and
Others have searched and given up the search. Others are walking with you, or they were walking with you, but the busyness of life has gotten in the way. No matter where we're at, Lord, we ask that you, once again, through the power of your mysterious Holy Spirit, enliven us, make us alive, give us a passion for you, direct our needs towards you, so that we can walk with you and then share that walk with others. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand for one closing song, a song of receiving God's blessings. Mysterious Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen. All right, as you leave, don't forget, parents, pick up the little bag. And if you see October 25, if you see a bunch of them sitting there and you're an adult but a child at heart, take one. I'm going to take one. I want to know what's in here. So who knows? There might be a golden ticket. I don't know what's in here. So please take one as you go out, and we'll see you again next week.